American movie maker John Milius is quite famous. He was co-screenwriter of such important movies as Dirty Harry and Apocalypse Now. Some of the most vivid and memorable quotes from there belong to his pen in particular. Thanks to Milius, appeared such a great TV series as Rome. But of course, most of all, he is known as the screenwriter and producer of cult movie from 1982, Conan the Barbarian. Looking at such impressive achievement list, one can assume that participants of Milius in making a movie can guarantee on the outcome to have, if not a masterpiece, then something close to it. The illusion is going to last until the very moment when you find yourself watching this something called Red Dawn. What is it? First of all, anti-Soviet propaganda. Of course, one can listen to noodles lovers, who say that bases for the movie are totally different, and USSR is only there for decoration. And generally, this is an alternate universe, a fantasy, anyways. It is all illusion of the modern world. Gods are not gods, titans are not titans, Greeks are not Greeks, and Hyperion is not Hyperion. These are all metaphors. However, facts remain facts. Soviets in the movie are shown real bloodsuckers, comparing to which the Nazis look like innocent babies. It was Red Dawn in particular that stimulated rebirth of, almost perished after the Caribbean crisis, movie genre, a genre where typical evil, bloodsucking Soviet animals is countered by typical good, American patriots and Democrats. However, Soviet Union has collapsed long ago, Cold War is over, and Russia and USA are now partners. We are allies. Allies for you, but for us, class enemies, god damn it. So then, maybe Milius' movie does not contain anything horrible by today's standards. Well, let's find out right now, shall we? Now then, movie of the year 1984, Red Dawn. Everything starts with well-painted black plates with inscriptions, where kind Uncle Milius is imagining the near future. And so, USSR is suffering from a horrible failed harvest of wheat, and occupies Poland, that demand bread. Probably to have more hungry mouths to feed. Simultaneously, Cuba and Nicaragua are capturing Salvador and Honduras. And a revolution takes place in Mexico, without a doubt, a socialist one. This is the way USSR is going to struggle against famine, in Milius' opinion, by grabbing territories of all countries and pump resources out of there, dooming their new comrades to hunger and poverty. Really, really similar to Soviet Union's style of doing things. But we remember, Russian bloodsuckers and Milius equals LFE. So then, we return to horrifying predictions. West Germany's Greens are gaining majority in the parliament, and demand, oh the horror, withdrawal of all nuclear weapons from Europe. But the most terrifying thing is not it. NATO dissolves, and USA is left alone, like this ever prevented them from doing things. When text introductions are over, some American shithole is shown to us. Patrick Swayze is bringing a couple of guys to school. One of them, young Charlie Sheen. The guy probably has no idea what he's gonna become when he grows up. In the school, a very important lesson is taking place. Remember that Milius does not have anything happening without a reason. Black teacher is narrating to children about bloodthirsty ghouls, Mongols, whose mad hordes were so severe that during the big hunt, they were killing everyone in sight. People, animals, and even bugs and grasshoppers. And they were like this for weeks and even months. Suddenly, paratroopers are starting to come down from the sky. Yes, it is them. They came, the devil's brats, modern-day Mongols. In other words, Soviet military. They wear strange camo and leather helmets of World War II pilots, and they run around like this after the descent. And generally, I must say that I haven't seen a single normal helmet on a Soviet soldier's head. Indeed, what do they need them for? Since bloodsuckers are not afraid of bullets, they are only scared of holy water and a wooden stick in the heart. Black teacher is coming out to beastly orcs, while perplexedly asking them who they are and what are they doing here. Oh, yeah, this is exactly the question you gotta ask paratroopers. And then, a complete madhouse is starting. Russian stone dudes first whacking the teacher, and after, starting to whack school kids. Everyone they lay eyes on, oh my god, they killed Kelly. Bastards. What for? Unclear. Even if you think about it, it's still unclear. The phrase soldier won't hurt a child is not about mealyous Russians. It's amazing they didn't start to chase ants. But, when they fire at school form and rebounds per game, you can't perceive seriously what is happening on the screen anymore. John Miles wanted to create something like this. But it turned out like this. Despite severe bloodthirstiness, Russians are behaving like a herd of sheep, run around in crowds, shooting everything in sight. And in addition, allowing American school kids to attack them, from behind. Pure clowns from circus. Suddenly, character of Patrick Swayze is bursting into this chaos. He picks up his little brother, a couple of his friends, and leaves. Meanwhile, it seems he turns on a cheat code. From now on, none of Soviet ghouls is capable of hitting their car. Even the ever-present Sever bazooka operator. We should remind once more that the movie is about citizens of a small American town, which is located somewhere in the center of the country. Strategic value, zero. So, the reason why the whole Soviet army is attacking it is impossible to understand. All the more so, it's not just passing through, but comes and stays. Why? Well, Russians probably lost their minds because of hunger. And so, heroes are leaving town, and after taking some cool stuff in the shop of one of guy's daddy, departing to hide in the mountains, but suddenly, evil orcs are closing their way on an APC. Screaming non-humans are shooting at the pickup truck with their eyes closed. School kids are panicking, but a noble American helicopter appears from out of nowhere. It shoots. Russians are running around like a bunch of apes, and dying in approximately the same way. It seems that school kids are saved. However, nothing was threatening them in the first place, since immortality code is still active. Then, we are shown a night battle. Well, what do I mean battle? An American helicopter. A single helicopter is attacking the town occupied by red mutants. And there is a whole army of them here, of course. But this doesn't prevent helicopter to calmly fly around and shoot. And they seem not to give rat's ass that there could be lots of their own civilians. Shoot, fire, kill. And what Soviets are doing? Nothing new. Screaming, panicking, running around like a herd of dumb sheep, but they still can't do anything with this one helicopter. Why? Well, because they are morons. Only these idiots on Shilka worth mentioning. This AA system, which in reality, and not in wet dreams of Melius, Americans were afraid like devil himself, is not even thinking of shooting. How these monkeys could even conquer someone is beyond me. A bum with a shotgun would have kicked asses of this army. Suddenly, a brave young Hussein is coming out of clouds of smoke. We are finally officially told that occupying forces are consisted of united armies of Soviets, Cubans, Nicaraguans, Mexicans, and God knows who else. This rabble is led not by Hussein, of course, but by Cuban Colonel Ernesto Bella. Judging by everything, it seems that he is the only person who has something remotely reminding a brain. Meanwhile, a bunch of scared school kids decided to remain in the mountains. But, not immediately. First, hysteria starts. because allegedly, they have almost nothing. Just this pickup truck full of food, tents, sleeping bags and weapons. But Swayze keeps everyone in line, without giving a damn about sacred principles of democracy. And so, a month passes. Children are learning how to survive in the wild, and to hunt. And in addition, little children are learning to drink fresh blood, without being afraid of millions of parasites it contains. School children, who just moments ago shot a deer, complaining that they are almost out of olives, and they are gonna need food. It seems that deer meat is not suitable for eating. And so, everyone as a chore are moaning that they are very hungry. Although, just moments ago, the leader of this madhouse was claiming that he spent lots of time in the mountains, saying that one could hunt here, catch fish, and live for months. And now they cannot. It's simply impossible. That deer killed the other day doesn't count. So, there is no choice. They must go to the city, well, you know, buy some burgers, tasty hot dogs, etc. healthy natural food, which their elf stomachs missed so much. Meanwhile, the town is completely enslaved by red werewolves. Americans are screwed to death. Colonel Bella is driving around in mayor's car with dumb camo with some chicks. Marxist-Leninist slogans are written everywhere. A KGB officer is hiding in every shadow. Squads of commie police are walking on the streets and burning the wrong books by tons. Good thing they weren't like Nazis doing it during a parade. Melia's nightmares becoming reality no less. Nevertheless, cheat code is still active, and our school kids are impudently walking round the town. Brave faces are shining on the sun, their clothes smell bonfire from a mile away. But, they are not stopped by anyone. And all this despite the fact that they are being hunted by none other than KGB itself. Some sales girl is telling them that red bastards have built their local gulag, where they are taking people by thousands. And our brave school kids are departing directly there, because KGB is not going to search for them in there, for sure. Swayze and his brother are talking with their father, without meeting any problems, and after weeping next to that net, going directly to a farmer they knew. The farmer equips them with horses and a frozen radiant transmitter and narrates them what kind of murderers, rapists and beasts Soviets are, while they're at it, to dramatize up the movie, so to speak. After reinforcing their squad with two schoolgirls, kids are returning to their camp. Well, returning how? Riding on their horses through an open field, without hiding, at all, like badasses, because no one is looking for them, especially KGB. On the next day, as much as three Russian bloodsuckers are appearing on the horizon, who just want to take some photos next to a plate with inscription about opening a new reserve. Russian guerrilla is sputtering something about battles of cowboys and Indians, and even manages to translate the numbers wrong. Well, what can you expect from these degenerates? They don't even have subordination. They are like locusts. Suddenly, bloodsuckers found an arrow and rambling about on top of the hill. School kids are hiding there, on the hillside, behind some rocks. What have they forgotten there? Only the producer knows. Did they want it to eavesdrop? What were they saying? Can any of them understand what these bloodsuckers are saying on their freakish jargon? Suddenly, one of the girls started to slide down the hill. Melius didn't think this through very well. Mordor servants, instead of showing their true beastly nature and shoot the elf with three guns, and then all together rape the body, while playing Soviet anthem and drinking hot vodka from a samovar, starting to chase her. School kids hurries for help. And one of this dumb wits drops his weapon. Of course, three upgraded orcs have no chance against underage Jedis with cheat codes. And all of them are falling like flies. But very, very slowly. Further, even more dramatizing of already dramatic events, ELFS are shot with machine guns while playing music from totalitarian hell. And for the scene to be more representative and heart-wrenching, they are trying to shout down Soviet anthem with their own, without being noticed by anyone. School kids are observing the execution, and taking the path of war at that same night. And right there, they came up with a genius strategic plan. Whack always, whack everywhere. A diesel-fueled tank is parking at a gas station, but the crew is asking to fill it up with benzene, for some reason. Immediately, a schoolgirl is arriving on a bicycle, probably out of gas too. A Soviet tank operator, like a drunk orangutan, is assaulting her. Our elf girl is robbed on the spot. But here, Milius is also screwed up. It's strange that they are not raping here right there on the tank armor, under sounds of balalaika. Stupid gibbons are throwing robbed things inside the tank, without checking them. Well, you know, they are locusts. Did you forget already? And, wow, that basket had a bomb inside. It seems that they are teaching how to make time bombs in American schools. Russians are assembling AKs in schools. And these are making bombs. But here's the catch, if this schoolgirl would have hesitated for even a minute, then it would have been the end of her. But not here. Explosion inside the tank, the girl is running, three orcs following here with a single prison shank, without even trying to shoot. Hey, what for? Even an idiot would know that she was running around here with a bomb all by herself. Yeah, but, easier said than done. Jedis are diving out of the ground, and killing these ghouls, etc., etc. School kids are gaining experience, rakishly shooting orcs, accurately throwing grenades in APS's hatches, setting up well-prepared ambushes. They are fighting against orcs after all. What kind of reconnaissance or air support can they have, when this dumb cattle can't see bonfire smoke in broad daylight, and fire during nighttime? Anyways, seven school kids are mocking Soviet Army in every possible way. Indeed. What World War III veterans can do against a group of teenagers? Clearly, nothing. Only run around like dumb sheep, and die by dozens at a time. All this looks like a video game recording, where super pro player is playing an FPS on kids' difficulty level. The squad of underage Terminators named themselves Wolverines, and created such a big fuss, that General of the Army himself came to deal with this. But, all in vain. Morale is collapsing, troops starting to panic. School children rule. Then, a shot-down pilot is joining this school fellowship. The guy is a real Jedi. More badass than Skywalker. Or even Yoda no less. He faced five enemy fires. And shot down four of them. The pilot is sharing information. Dash World War III is raging. Soviets annihilated almost the whole world. And now, it seems, attempted to capture a stronghold of democracy, with an assault. Sent traitors here, dropped a few nukes there, and then, sent the army. Minus 1 million men, according to the most optimistic calculations. Maybe even 2 million, not counting the allies, but, since they are a bunch of orcs, who can't even catch some school kids. And this is the reason war is still continuing. Forces of freedom and justice are successfully holding the territories, and repelling attacks of red bloodsuckers. The pilot is joining the squad, and participates in sabotage operations. Like capturing the local Gulag, which is guarded by a whole company, a two-carrier-capable assaulters made of plywood. Where from? What for? Why? Unclear. The attack is performed as usual, Tom and Jerry style. School kids are bursting in the camp on a truck, shooting from bazookas and machine guns. Soviets, like dumb bots from a second-grade video game, are dying like flies. Benny Hill show continues. And so, time passes. Day after day. School kids are living full and flourishing life, calmly playing football, right in the middle of an open field. Well, what should they be afraid of? Since Hairy Hand of the Producer will save them from any trouble. When January comes, the pilot is bringing the children to the front line. Allegedly, he has to go to the other side. A battle takes place. Well, what kind of battle? A couple of American planes are flying back and forth and hammering a forest. Somewhere in this forest, a lonely tank of Yanks is idling from the other side, slowly crawling a couple of T-72s. Or something like this, upholstered with plywood, a slow-paced tank battle starts. And our school kids found themselves in the center of all this. Suddenly, one of our underage Terminator loses his shit. Before this, for months, almost single-handedly he was mowing hundreds of demons from Red Inferno, and now he is panicking. Although, nobody is even shooting directly at him. As the result, one of the most miserable combats in history is taking place on the screen, in which the pilot and one of dudes are falling. Oh, the horrors. Cheat code didn't work. But this is only the beginning. Especially for school kids' extermination, a chastener squad of paratroopers is arriving, headed by a colonel, who eclipses the sun with his dazzling badassness. His speech worth special attention, which brings tears to people's eyes.
Что наш сектор изморения растет больше. Войну вы победите, только истребляет врагов. Мы бьемся за солдатами.
Nevertheless, even his badassness isn't enough to deal with a bunch of kids. In the broad daylight, a squad of Russian professionals, who is searching for God knows what with a device for measuring electrical resistance, falls into low trap, and dies. By some kind of investigation, dudes figure out that there is a traitor amongst them. Allegedly, one of school children was given up to the bloodsuckers by his own daddy, who appears to be the mayor, by the way. It appears that special services forced one of the dudes to swallow a bug and return to his pals. Understand? It turns out that these paratroopers, the elite of Soviet Army, were purposefully going to the school kids. They knew where kids are gathering. All the more so, planned this operation in advance, but still managed to fall into a trap. I wonder, whether is it Milius so stupid, or does he make Russians such idiots deliberately, so they won't look too frightening? School kids are shooting the traitor, but it does not help them too much. Very soon, kids are falling into a trap themselves, by getting caught on an old hunter's trick. Red executioners are leaving some grubs on a side of the road. With a bug inside for sure. Probably in potato chips. As soon as school kids got all comfy to have a meal, without hiding, when three military helicopters suddenly appear from behind the mountains. They are shooting at the kids from their main weapons. That is, missiles. One could assume that a direct hit of such missile would turn a man into mincemeat and terribly wound with shreds those who are next to him. However, when a missile hits one of schoolgirls, it suddenly turns into a bullet and only wounds her. In addition, huge holes in her body does not prevent her from jumping on a horse. Kids' squad loses two more of their members. One of them epically shoots at a helicopter, without activating cheat code, and so he is taken down by machine gun fire. The other, wounded elf female, is asking for a hand grenade, which she is bravely hiding under her running cold body. A hi to red necrophiles, so to speak. Helicopters, instead of making another assault and destroy everyone left alive, are flying away, for some crazy reason. After a little thinking, Swayze and Sheen are sending their pals behind enemy lines, and deciding to perform a bloody raid on Red Bloodsucker's base, for punishment. What for? Man, what kind of question is this? To enjoy cheats as much as possible. Meanwhile, Ernesto is writing a letter to his wife. This is kind of a crafty move from producer's side. Allegedly, our upgraded Cuban commando suddenly reached enlightenment. It turns out that he is tired of war and wants to rest in warm places. Saying that results of the revolution turned out to be much worse than its ideas. At the same exact moment, two super bros are attacking. And comparing to them, even Rambo, Commando, and Walker, Texas Ranger altogether, are nervously smoking in a corner, while observing feet of their compatriots.
Stallone, Statham, Lundgren, Norris, а также Ван Дам, Уиллис,
The exterminated, too. Red blood suckers are pointlessly dying by dozens, shooting everywhere, but not at our heroic school kids. But it's not over yet. Kids, running away on a train, which nobody even thinks of stopping, through fog of war, are noticed by the wicked degenerate, Colonel. He immediately starts to shoot without aiming, from a non-standard weapon, and hits Sheen. After this mind-blowing success, Comrade Dracula is chasing after our loose cannon patriots, without even calling anyone for backup. But hey, what for, right? Because in this case, the bros are certainly done for it. So he goes by himself. Well, goes how? Standing all happy, next to bloodstains, and smiling like a retard. Well, what else did you expected from a commander of orcs? That he is going to carefully sneak, while taking cover behind obstacles? Yeah, right. But Swayze is not leaving him be. He comes out standing up, and even saying something. In addition, unfortunately, he doesn't know yet that the producer have already determined his and his brother's fate, and cheat code is turned off. Death of two innocent ELFs, who assaulted an army of orcs, and glamorously died, carries much more dramatic message than their feats. Colonel and Swayze are shooting each other. Satan's messenger dies instantly. But wounded Swayze, without obvious effort, is carrying his border on his hands. Suddenly, the brave revolutioner is jumping out of nowhere, and lets two ELFs go, following by squeamish dropping of his assault rifle. Seems strange, because if he would have started to shoot his own guys, educational effect would have been even more graphical. Like saying, look how a person has changed. Everything ends with two surviving ELFs, from super epic school LOL team, came out of occupation zone. And soon enough, the war itself was over. Although, unclear how and why. But it's not important. Because all this was done to show in the end a piece of Iraq with names of our epic kids, who are using cheat codes without any regrets. Red Dawn conclusions. Red Dawn is the definition of a cheesy movie. A Russophobe's nightmare becoming reality, who sleeps and sees how red orcs are landing on the promised land directly from hell. And everything is done in this style. The producer is showing Soviet people as vicious wild animals. And in addition, this is very important, as extremely dumb and uneducated amateurs. Ones can only despise and hate such people, but never respect or even fear. Of course we can pretend that the movie is not about this at all. The basis of the plot lies the principle, which appears to be Melia's trademark. He puts his heroes in the so-called life-threatening situations, where they show their true essence. They are dropping moral restraints, and showing what they are capable of in the most extreme situations. And Red Dawn was planned to do exactly this. Regular school children are meeting a terrible enemy. They are forced to live in harsh conditions. They grow up fast, and civilizedness goes away pretty fast, and all the rest blah blah blah. But for a viewer could sympathize the heroes, they must show something at least remotely reminding the reality. But here, a bunch of hesitant, constantly filled with emotions kids are put in such situation, that it's known in advance, that it's impossible for them to lose. Until producer says so, of course. With the same success, the heroes could have come out to a battlefield completely naked, blindfolded and with their hands up, and everything would be exploding all the same, and the enemies would be running around like sheep, and die by dozens. No less questions is rising the fact that nobody but a bunch of pupils wants to fight for their freedom. We are constantly persuaded about influence of Wolverines on people's minds. But their underground movement, instead of multiplying, does the complete opposite, decaying, with every lost member. From artistic point of view, the movie also can't withstand any criticism. Everything is dragged and repetitive. Unrealistic worries of the teenagers are followed by all the same unrealistic battles. And all this until the end of the movie. Several sources mention that Milius was a military advisor in some university related to the army. However, judging by talentlessly set up idiotic cartoony and hopeless combat scenes in the movie, it's hard to believe this, to say the least, unless he was employed in propaganda department. Despite over-the-top delirium, Red Dawn made some serious cash. 2 times more than cult movie The Thing, and 2 times less than all the same cult movie The Terminator. How would you explain it? Cold War and fear of USSR? Or simply because of the fact that people simply love to see things where their own are shown as noble heroes, and others, stupid cattle? I don't know the answer, but the movie did earn some fame, and in November 2012, a remake came out in American theaters. Although, I seriously doubt that replacing Soviet bloodsuckers with Korean bloodsuckers can change anything. This is it for tonight. This was Red Cynic. Watch good movies, but don't forget about books as well.